Amen. When Jesus says yes, nobody can say no. Let's give them another round of applause and thank God for our youth, for their parents, and for the leaders of the youth ministry. Amen. Amen. That's all right. It is now time for a benevolent offering. As you prepare your hearts to give, let us be reminded that God loves a cheerful giver. And as the ushers prepare to make their way, we're also making time for those who are waiting on the outside to come on in on the inside so they also can participate in this part of our service. Amen. 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 For our youth ushers, let us pray. Gracious God, our Father, we thank you for the opportunity to give. Recognizing that all things come from you, we give back unto you so that those who might have need might be blessed by the gifts that we present on today. Lord, we just ask you bless this offering. Let it be used for your kingdom in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
us in Christ, let us forgive one another. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. At this time, we'd like to acknowledge anyone who's here worshiping with us for the first time on today. We know there are many churches that you could have visited, but we're so happy that you came to worship with Christ the King. Would you please stand and remain standing to receive your welcome, all first-time guests. At this time, we'd also like to invite those who have worshiped with us before, but you're not united with us. You've been here before, and maybe you're worshiping for a second or a third time. We'd like to ask if you would remain standing and receive your welcome, our returning guests. Amen. We're certainly glad to have you with us again, and at this time, we're going to ask the entire congregation to let's stand up and share some love with one another and greet our guests.
Too fast.
Yeah, like I remember different stuff that happened around Youth Month. Like, remember every Youth Month, you got to sing in the choir.
Yeah. Both services.
We used to get snacks.
Yeah, that was good. The snacks
Those were good parts. And then, what's Tyler? Oh, when we had youth church down here instead of in the fellowship hall. Yeah. Y'all remember that with Reverend Blackburn?
Well, even before that, we had it over in the fellowship hall.
And we had children's church.
Yeah.
In the classroom.
Yeah.
Yep. Way back in the day, those kids don't know anything about that now. The games we had in these rooms, there was like a whole like arcade type of room. Yeah, like air hockey and everything. Those were good times with the ushers, especially with Miss Kathy.
Oh yeah.
Every Saturday we had the meetings. It was a good time though for the ushers. I don't know about you were in the choir.
Oh, the choir was always fun.
Always fun.
We up there with Nene, we up there with Miss Nitty used to be up there. Who else? Miss Demetra. It was everybody up there.
Right. It's crazy. I mean, we're 21, you're 18, like all the youth now. You should really come out and volunteer for the youth ministry because it's a great time. You see, we have endless memories, and these are just the memories we had time to share with you all. So come out and be a part of the youth ministry.
Our annual Youth Month is a time where youth and children in our congregation and in the community are highlighted. It's a time where children can enjoy and appreciate being young. They have the opportunity to exhibit their talents, voice their opinions, make decisions, and grow spiritually. They also have an opportunity to use the skills and knowledge learned in the ministries to serve and witness to other youth in the community. Annual Youth Month provides a comfortable atmosphere where children and youth can come to God just as they are.
Youth Day celebration culminates the Youth Month's activities, and today we praise God for the youth and children that He's given us. We celebrate their present and future lives in Christ. It's a day to encourage them to trust in the Lord and not to lean on their own understanding, that in all their ways they should acknowledge Him, and He will direct their paths. Let's continue, parents, to train them up God's way.
Happy Youth Month, Christ the King!
Good afternoon, Pastor, Reverend Cash, and church family. At this time, may I have all of the youth leaders and the youth of CTK please stand? As they are standing, would Miss Marilyn and Reverend Carla please come forward? Alicia Wilson. During my 14 years as a member of Christ the King Church, the two of you have been very instrumental in my spiritual and personal growth, and for that, I thank you. At this time, we have a few tokens of appreciation to show how much you both mean to the New Generation Youth Ministry and its leaders. First, we have Jason Jackson and Julius Marino presenting one token of appreciation.
Now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are differences of administrations, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of operation, but it is the same God which worketh all in all. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 4 through 6.
Miss Marilyn and Reverend Carla, it is with great appreciation we say thank you for your love, support, and guidance. Thank you for your time, talent, and treasure in service to the Lord. We praise Him for giving you the gifts you possess and the heart to share them. Thank you for being Jesus' hands and feet among us.
Next, we have Lawrence Bell and Jaden Lewis. Lastly, we have Desiree Murray and Stasia Elms. Thank you for all of your support and dedication. And to the leaders, we thank you and appreciate you as well. Church family, please join the New Generation Youth Ministry in giving Miss Marilyn, Reverend Carla, and our leaders a hearty round of applause. Pastor, please come forward. Without you and your vision, the New Generation Youth Ministry and Christ the King Church would not exist. This is just a small token of our love and appreciation for you. With sincerity, we thank you for all that you do. Pastor, because you are the wind beneath our wings, we will continue laboring with the right motivation.
Amen. They certainly deserve the honor because our children are our future. Amen. Amen. I have a few additional announcements. Please save the dates for the Milwaukee Associates in Ministry Annual Conference on Ministry on June 28th through June 30th at 6:30 p.m. nightly here at Christ the King. This is a mandatory conference for our CTK leaders, but it's open to all members and to the public. This is the last week for outdoor sales. Please go over after service to support the youth department. This week, our food sponsors are Pamela Bell and Deacon Michael and Elaine Harper. King's Academy is hiring. Amen. King's Academy is hiring for a financial administrator. Please call Anita Peterson at 414-371-5000 or send your resume to anita.peterson@ctkbc.org. Also, happy birthday to all of the June CTK members. There will be cake in the fellowship hall for all to enjoy. Final note, the deacons will be standing in front of the communion table after both services for those in desiring individual or family prayer. It is now time for our altar prayer. We know that we serve an all-hearing, all-seeing, all-knowing God, so He knows the concerns of our hearts. We may have something that we wish to bring to the altar, knowing that if we cast our cares on Him, He cares for us and He is faithful. Amen. Or maybe we want to stand in the gap for someone who we desire to pray for. Current on our prayer list, we want to just lift up our prayers for Lawrence Bell, who will be traveling with Impact Movement for mission work to Ghana, West Africa, from July 3rd until August 7th. Also on our bereaved list, Lincoln Heron, brother of Bertha Heron, passed on Friday, June 17th. He was privately memorialized on Thursday, June 23rd at Golden Gate Funeral Home. We also wish to lift up Ella Geneva Brown, grandmother of Reverend Nakisha Brown, passed on June 23rd. Services will be Thursday, June 30th at Lighthouse Fellowship Church in Beloit, Wisconsin.
Thank you.
bow your heads and close your eyes. Dear Lord, we come to you today to give you honor and praise. You are worthy of our praise. You are the source of all that is good. You are the source of all of our blessings. We first want to start off by saying thank you. Thank you for every gift that we have been given. Thank you for giving us life, waking us up each and every morning, and helping us get through our day no matter what you throw at us. We thank you for providing us with all of your love and unconditionally. We thank you for the opportunity to come and gather together on this day. Lord, we thank you and hope that you will strengthen us, restore us, and inspire us with your love. Help us be filled with your peace. Lord, heal the wounded and help them get back where they need to be. We ask that our souls would catch the wind of your spirit so that we could take your promises to all of your children. We pray that you will not only help guide the youth, but also have them follow you and spread your word. We pray that you will not only watch over us, but protect us from all the violence and help us get through it all. And whatever we may be going through at this time, help us get through it. Lastly, we ask that you would guide our thoughts and our actions so that we can be successful in life. Help us accomplish our goals while honoring you through your word. We pray these things in your mighty name. Amen.
To the hour where we'd like to introduce our guest speaker for today. Today we have with us Reverend Brian Cash. Reverend Cash is a native of Cleveland, Ohio. He accepted his calling to the ministry at the age of 14 and was licensed to preach at age 17. Currently, Reverend Cash serves as minister over children, youth, and young adults at the New Mount Olive Baptist Church in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. Reverend Cash graduated from Vanderbilt Divinity School, earning a Master's of Divinity with a concentration in Black Church Studies. Additionally, he served as Vice President of Community Outreach for several Black organizations on Vanderbilt Graduate School campus, including Black Seminarians, Good Men, and the Organization of Black Graduate Students. After the choir, the next voice you will hear will be that of Reverend Brian Cash. Let us greet him with a hearty amen and praise.
the lines then, delivered from my sin. You notice a change in me cause I've been born again. And got the same feelings to kick it with old friends. I'm living a new life. In Christ, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. Five stripes, I'm healed. I don't need a doctor. Jesus Christ is my savior. Born in a manger, died and came back 3 days. Easter. Mercy, I came back 100-fold when I saw the white sea. Okay. I worship the Lord of Lords, Alpha and Omega. Gave me dominion all around the equator. Yeah. I can't stop, I won't stop till the sweat drop. Okay. I just got adopted and became a son of God. Persuaded neither death nor life. Cause never worth the love of God with the sin quest. Come on. Hey. Hey.
Gracious and kind God, we give you thanks. We thank you, God, that you have been better to us than we can ever be to ourselves. And for that, we say thank you. We thank you, God, for the move of your spirit in this place. We ask, God, that your spirit will continue to show up mightily in this place. Lord, it's preaching time. Lord, do what you do best. Show up in this place. Eliminate us from all distractions. Allow us to concentrate on the word from you. Lord, we need you this morning because we cannot do anything without you. Lord, do what you do best. Show up in this place. And we'll be happy to give you the praise, honor, and glory that's due to your name. It is in your name that we pray. Everybody said amen. Come on, give God a hand clap of praise. Amen. You may be seated. Amen. Amen. God is certainly worthy to be praised. From the rising of the sun to the setting of the saints, God is worthy to be praised. Come on, give God some praise in this place. Amen. Would you help me celebrate these youth behind me? Would you help? Come on. Come on. Come on, y'all can do better than that. Help me celebrate these children behind me. Amen. Amen. Now, would you help me celebrate your pastor, the visionary of this church? Amen. 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 We're excited to be here on this morning. There is a word found in Ezekiel chapter number 37. Ezekiel chapter number 37. Ezekiel chapter. Consecrate me, Lord, to thy service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. Let my soul look on with a steadfast hope, and my will be lost in thine. Draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Ezekiel chapter 37 says, the hand of the Lord was upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me down in the middle of a valley, and it was full of bones. He led me around them, and there were many lying in the valley, and they were very dry. He said to me, mortal, can these bones live? I answered, O Lord God, you know. Then he said to me, prophesy to these bones and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord God to these bones, I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. I will lay sinews on you, and I will cause flesh to cover upon you and cover you with skin and put breath in you, and you shall live, and you shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded, and as I prophesied, suddenly there was a noise, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to its bone. I looked, and there were sinews on them, and flesh had covered upon them, and skin had covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, mortal, and say to the breath, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live. I prophesied as I was commanded, and the breath came into them, and they lived and stood on their feet, a vast multitude. For a moment this morning, I want to talk on this subject, just chill.
Would you look to your neighbor beside you and help me and say, neighbor, chill out. That was the wrong neighbor. Some of y'all didn't say nothing to nobody. Look at somebody else and say, neighbor, oh neighbor, oh neighbor, just chill. Come on, give God a hand clap of praise. Brothers and sisters, one of the leading causes of death for us is high blood pressure, diabetes, stress. High blood pressure and stress is as a result of something I call worry. Literally, brothers and sisters, many of us worry about everything. Some of you right now are worried about something so much that you cannot even listen or participate in the worship service because you've allowed something to consume your mind and your entire life. You go to bed at night worrying. You wake up in the morning worrying. You go to work during the day, you're worried about something. You're worried about somebody. You're worried about something. You're worried about a financial issue. You are just literally consumed by worry. All of us worry as a result of the pressure we have in our lives because many of us deal and have so much going on in our weekly schedule that it's not easy to not worry because worry has just become a part of our regular schedule. All of us worry. Worry is not the issue because it doesn't matter how many times you're going to tell yourself you ain't going to worry about it, you're going to worry about it anyways. But brothers and sisters, worry is common. All of us do it. The issue is when you allow worry to consume your life. The word worry in its original English language literally comes from this idea to mean that you have allowed something to choke your life away. It comes from this original idea to literally take the breath away from you. And some of you have allowed your situations, your circumstances, your problems to literally take the life out of you. You cannot smile. You cannot be happy. You cannot be jubilant because you have allowed something to worry you to death. It causes you to frustrate about everything. It causes you to stress out about everything. It causes you to even complain about everything. Have you ever met somebody whose life is literally consumed with the stuff they're going through in their life? They always are complaining, stressed out, frustrated, going crazy about everything. It doesn't even matter if it's something small to you. A little thing just causes them to go off the deep end and they just worry and complain and stress out about everything. I know people who just complain about everything. You tell them that it's a sunny day today, they tell you it's gonna rain tomorrow. You tell them life is good, they tell you life ain't good all the time. You tell them they look good today, they tell you I could look better if I had a little bit more money. They just literally complain about everything. It doesn't matter if they got money in the bank. It doesn't matter if the children are doing well. It doesn't matter if life is good for them. They will find something to complain about. I've discovered, brothers and sisters, that all of us have been to that place where we've allowed something to consume our minds. Some of you sitting right now and you're thinking about something you worried about. Worry has a way of consuming your life. It will cause you to not see the beauty out of life, but it will cause you to always see something negative in life. That resembles the children of Israel. The children of Israel, brothers and sisters, had this issue of worry and complaining. They literally worried and complained about everything. When things did not go their way, they complained about it. When God didn't do what they wanted him to do, they worried and complained about it. The Bible says that God brought them out of Egypt and put them in the wilderness free from the rule of the Egyptians, and they complained. Bible says God gave them fruit food from heaven. They complained about that. He said, God, we don't want this food. We want the manna from heaven. God gave them manna from heaven. They complained about that. Got to the promised land and God set them up nice. They had everything they needed. They didn't have to worry about anything. God provided all of their needs and all of their desires. They start looking around at other kings and kingdoms and they said, God, we don't want judges. We want kings and queens like everybody else. They literally complained about everything. Ezekiel chapter number 37 is a reminder of how the children of Israel were some complaining folk. The Bible says that God comes to Ezekiel in around the 15th verse and says, Ezekiel, my children are complaining again. They have said, I have left them and abandoned them. So Ezekiel, I have a word for you to give to my people because they are complaining about stuff they can't control. And the word I want to give to you is, remind them, stop worrying, start chilling. Literally, he takes Ezekiel to a place called a valley of dry bones, below sea level, and shows him this impossible place, and says, Ezekiel, I have a word for my people, because they are discouraged and complaining. But before you can give this word to them, what you first of all have to do is come down here and live out the word before you can share the word. Can I remind you, brothers and sisters, every once in a while, the Lord will have you live out your testimony and your message before you can actually give it. He takes Ezekiel down below sea level. He says, before you can give the word, you first of all have to live out the word. And many of you come to church every Sunday talking about the Lord has heard my cry, talking about I trust in the Lord, talking about I have faith in God. God has a way of putting you in some stuff so that the stuff you say on Sunday morning has some validity to it. You tell God, God, I trust you. God, I'm searching after you. God will take some money away from you. God will put you in some crazy situations to really see how much you say you have faith in me. You tell God, God, I love you and I'm going to trust you no matter what. God will put some folk in your life that will cause all kind of hell, and the only person you can really trust is the Lord. So when you really come in here on Sunday morning, you won't be telling folk what you heard. You'll be telling some folk, I really know that I can trust the God, because when everybody else failed me, when everybody else was away from me, I trust God and he was with me. He has a way of making you live out that stuff you talk about. Takes Ezekiel down below sea level and he says, Ezekiel, look at this impossible situation. I want you to remind the children of Israel that they are, yes, in an impossible situation, but you are in an impossible situation that you have no control over. And all I want you to know is stop worrying about this stuff you can't control. Let me handle it and you just chill. I don't know who's that for this morning. And you've been worrying about some stuff you really can't control. I don't understand why people worry about stuff they can't control. You can't fix it on your own. Why worry about it? God reminds us through this little narrative in Ezekiel chapter 37. He's in control and all you need to do is just chill. It sounds good. How does it work? I know many of you are looking at me like, Cash, you really don't know my life. You don't know the stuff I go through on a day-to-day basis. You don't know how bad my children are. You don't know how much hell I endure on work schedules and work every week. How do I really chill? It sounds good. How does it work? Three things I'll be out your way. In order for you to just chill, the first thing you must acknowledge is that the Lord is directing your path. Verse number one says, the hand of the Lord led me to a valley of dry bones. Catch this. He says, it was the hand of the Lord. The hand of the Lord is an expression to remind us how God directs and leads us. That we do not get anywhere unless God is directing our lives. The hand of the Lord directed me. But catch this, what he says. He says, the hand of the Lord directed me by way of the Spirit of God. He says, catch this, even though the hand of God was leading me, I didn't get anywhere unless I was connected to the Spirit of God. You see, the hand of God is like your GPS in your car. But the Spirit of God is like your engine in your car. You see, you can have the best GPS system in the world, but if you got a bummed out engine, you just got directions leading you, but you ain't going nowhere. And I've discovered some of us brothers and sisters are still in the same spiritual grunts that we've been in 20 years ago. Why? Because we come to church, but we ain't connected to His Spirit. I moved into a new apartment this year. When I moved into the new apartment, the lady, before I went up there, she says, here, take this sheet. This sheet is everything detail of what's in the apartment. She said, if something is wrong, let me know, mark it, and we'll come fix it. Went into the apartment, looked at everything. Bathroom was nice. Bedroom was nice. Living room was nice. And I start checking the plugs. Start plugging my phone into all of the outlets. And all of a sudden, I came to one outlet that didn't work. I called the lady. I said, ma'am, this outlet does not work. She said, are you sure? I said, yes, ma'am. I'm looking at the thing right now. It does not work. She says, well, have you looked at the switches on the wall? I said, yeah, that's to the light. What does that have to do with the outlet on the wall? She says, there are two switches, right? I said, yes. I flipped the one switch. It turned on the light. But then I switched the other switch, and all of a sudden, my phone came on. Literally, I was plugged into something that had no power. You know what I've discovered, brothers and sisters? The reason why many of us are not going anywhere is because we are plugged into people and things that have no power. We're plugged into people and we're asking them for marital advice and they've been divorced for years. We plugged into people who are always negative, don't have nothing good to say. Can I help you, brothers and sisters? If you are going move forward, you cannot be plugged into things that have no power. You got to be plugged into something that gives you life and life more abundantly. Catch what he says. I made it to the valley only because the Lord allowed me to be connected to him. Maybe you need to ask yourself, what am I plugged into? Many of you are plugged into the wrong things. You plugged into Housewives of Atlanta. You plugged into all of those different series and shows when you ought to turn that off and be plugged into the right thing. Because when you plug into him, he'll give you power that allows you to do stuff you never imagined you can do. Yeah, many of us skip Bible study so we can go watch a show. That means you plugged into the wrong thing. Catch this. He says, not only when the Lord directs your path, you can chill because you're connected to the right source, but then also the hand of the Lord not only is a directing mechanism, but it's also a delivering mechanism. Whenever you see that expression, the hand of the Lord, it not only suggests that God is directing me, but when the hand of the Lord shows up, it also means that God is taking me from a bad situation to a better situation. Deuteronomy chapter number 6, verse number 20, what we shared this morning, it says the mighty hand of the Lord delivered the children of Israel from bondage to the promised land. What the hand of the Lord means, God is taking me from bad to good. But catch this, that ain't what happens here. Text says the hand of the Lord delivers Ezekiel to a valley of dry bones. You really wouldn't understand what I'm saying unless you knew where Ezekiel came from. You see, where God gets Ezekiel is, Ezekiel is in slavery. He's in bondage. So literally the picture is God takes Ezekiel from slavery to isolation. He takes Ezekiel from bondage to a valley of some dirty, dry bones. Doesn't make any sense. Why would the Lord come get his prophet and take him from a bad place to a worse place? Well, it's in the word valley. You see, a valley is geographically positioned between two mountains. Do you remember when children of Israel came out of Egypt, they went into the wilderness, a valley. They went, ran into the Red Sea. They could not go backwards because there was an army behind them. They could not go forwards because there was a sea in front of them. They could not go right and left because there were two mountains beside them. They were in a in-between place. You know, Christ the King, I've discovered, sometimes when the Lord is leading you, he will put you in an in-between place. He will put you in places where you really are unsure of where you're going and how you're going to get there. You see, in-between places are the most confusing places because you've never been to this place before and you're wondering what the Lord is going to do next in your life. In-between places are when you are waiting on God's performance after you receive God's promise. God told you he would take care of you, but you're trying to figure out how is God going to take care of me. God told you all things work together for the good of those who love the Lord, but you're trying to figure out how all of this bad stuff going to start working for your good. You are in an in-between place. You know what I learned about being in an in-between place? Sometimes God will put you in an in-between place so he can get you by yourself and he can work on you and make you who he wants you to be. I think I said it one more time. Every once in a while, the Lord will put you in an in-between place because in in-between places, you are by yourself and God has your full divided attention and he can make you who he wants you to be. Some of you got that testimony. It wasn't until I got in my in-between place that I learned who I really was. Many of you have been worrying and asking God, why have you allowed me to be single so long? God says, I put you single so long so you can work on yourself and you can learn how to love yourself and not need love from nobody else. Every once in a while, God will put you in an in-between place. You know, many of us mess up our in-between places. We don't take advantage of the in-between place because while we're going through, we're too busy complaining and frustrated and going crazy asking God all these why questions when you ought to be asking God, what can I learn from this in-between place? That's why you were broke so long. So when you got some money, you knew how to manage your money and you wouldn't mess it over. Many of us be broke and when we get some money, we just squander it and spend it everywhere. Why? Because we didn't take advantage of the in-between place. So many of you need to learn how to chill in the in-between place because God has led you there so he can work on you and make you who he wants you to be. You ought to celebrate the fact that you're in an in-between place. You ought to celebrate the fact that you're down right now because whenever you are down, God can reach down and bring you to the place he wants you to be. Because whenever you make it out of the valley, there is a mountain that he wants you to take advantage of. But if you didn't learn your lesson in the valley, you will never be able to handle the mountain. And the Lord is directing your path. But not only is the Lord directing my path that I can chill, I'll chill next of all when I acknowledge my lack of knowledge. Look at the text. He says, Ezekiel, puts him in the middle, puts him in the valley of dry bones. Then he asks him this crazy question. He said, look at the bones. He says, Ezekiel, can these bones live? But notice where he places Ezekiel and then notice what he calls Ezekiel. Are y'all Bible still open or y'all just looking at me? Look at what he says. He says, Ezekiel, he places Ezekiel in where? The middle of the bones. He doesn't place Ezekiel above the bones. He doesn't place Ezekiel in front of the bones. He places him right in the middle of the bones. And And listen to what he asks, what he calls Ezekiel. He does not say, Ezekiel, can these bones live? What does he say? He says, son of man, can these bones live? Literally what happens, he places Ezekiel in the middle of this impossible situation and reminds Ezekiel of his own human limitations. He says, Ezekiel, I'm going to put you in the middle of your mess and remind you, you can't even fix it. I think I'll say that one more time. He places him right in the middle of his own mess and then reminds Ezekiel, you don't even have the intellectual capacity to fix the problem. You know what I've discovered, y'all? Every once in a while, God will put you right in the middle of your own mess to remind you, you can't fix this thing, and the only one that can fix it is the one that created it. You know, the problem with us is when God puts us in our mess, what do? We try to fix it. You know why you can't fix it? You didn't create it. You remember that story, Humpty Dumpty? Yeah, I always was baffled by that story because it didn't make sense. Humpty Dumpty sat on the wall. Humpty Dumpty had a great fall. All the king's men, all the king's horses could not put him back together again. I always wondered how you got all these smart people in this city and nobody can put him back together again. Y'all didn't ask that question? But you know why they couldn't put him back together again? They didn't make it. Literally, they were trying to put something back together again that they didn't make in the first place. And I discovered many of you are stressing and worrying over stuff you don't have any power over. And all you've got to learn to do is realize I don't have the knowledge to fix this, but the one who created it has the power to handle it. And I've discovered, brothers and sisters, you've got to learn how to put your mess in the person's hands who made it in the first place. Doesn't matter if it's a child, doesn't matter if it's a financial situation. The Bible says that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, and they that dwell within it. So if the earth is the Lord's, why don't I put God's problems in God's hands? He says you've got to acknowledge your lack of knowledge. You've got to acknowledge that the Lord is directing your path. Then last of all, I'm finished, y'all. You got to acknowledge the power that exists within. Listen to what he says. He says, Ezekiel, prophesy to the bones. He says, Ezekiel, prophesy. When Ezekiel prophesies, catch what happens. The bones come together. Then he says, Ezekiel, prophesy to the winds. Catch what happens when he prophesies to the winds. The Bible says that the wind comes and breathes in these dead bones, in these dead individuals, and guess what happens? They come alive. The strange thing is, why would God have Ezekiel prophesy two times? Wouldn't God know that in order for the bones to come alive, you got to have breath in the bones? Wouldn't the Lord know that these dead, full of skin bones will never come alive unless there's breath in the bones? Why would he have Ezekiel prophesy two times? Well, he had him prophesy two times because the Lord knows us better than we know ourselves. And the Lord knows that we are fascinated with what goes on the outside. He knows you'll spend hours upon hours in the mirror making sure your weave and your makeup is together because you are concerned about what goes on the outside. He knows you'll spend all of your money and not have money to pay your rent on clothes and shoes because you are concerned about what goes on the outside. He knows you will shop until you drop and mess up your budget only because you are concerned about what goes on the outside. So God knew this about us, and so he said, I'm going to put the best show man has ever seen, bones having flesh, come upon them. It literally transformed from a cemetery to a funeral home. This had never happened before. There were dead bodies all in the valley. They look good. I mean, you should have saw these bones. They had flesh on them. They came together in synergy. It was the best show man had ever seen. But the problem was they were still dead. Then God tells Ezekiel, prophesy to the winds. And when he prophesies to the winds, the bones come alive. He wanted Ezekiel to send a message to those complaining people in bondage. Guess what? It doesn't matter what you have, and it doesn't matter who you are. You'll never come alive until the Lord breathes in you. Doesn't matter how many clothes you wear. Doesn't matter how much money you got in the bank. Doesn't matter how many degrees you have on the wall. The reason why you are who you are is because of the stuff that's inside of you. Can I help somebody, brothers and sisters? The reason why you went through the same thing somebody else went through, they went crazy, committed suicide, left the world, and did all kind of crazy stuff, is because you have something within you that makes you get up every time you want to lay down. It makes you keep going every time you want to quit. Is there anybody here who knows the reason why I'm where I am today? It ain't because of who I am, and it ain't because of what I have. It's only because I got something on the inside of me. It said the bones came alive, and the only reason they stood up is because he put something in them. And I want to submit to you, brothers and sisters, you need to stop worrying and stop complaining, because you got something within you that allows you to get back everything you lost. That's why Job said, the Lord gives and the Lord takes away, but blessed be the name of the Lord. Why? Because I got something on the inside of me that allows me to get everything I might lose in life. I'm finished. I bored y'all too long. Yeah, that's a story. That's a story my friend tells, but how they were at his house, and his younger brother, they were in the pool, and they were swimming in the pool, and his father, their father, took this large ball. He had to blow it up with air, blew the ball up and threw it into the pool. They start playing with the ball in the pool. The younger brother took the ball and he submerged the ball underwater. It kept rising up. Took the ball again, submerged it underwater, and it kept rising up. Looked to his older brother. He said, brother, why does this ball keep rising up? He said, I took some heavy stuff, threw it in the pool, and it stayed at the bottom of the pool. But I take this ball filled with air, push it under the water, and it keeps rising up. He said, tell me why. Why does this ball rise up every time I put it under? He said, the reason why the ball rise up is because daddy blew into it. Y'all just don't know when to shout, do you? The reason why you where you are today is because your father blew into you. The reason why you have all you have today is because your daddy blew into you. Is there anybody here who can celebrate the fact that I'm chilling today because I've got a father who blew into me? The reason why I'm not worried, I'm not complaining, I'm not stressed out, I ain't going crazy, is because I serve a God who blew into me. Somebody in this place ought to touch your neighbor and tell your neighbor, I'm chilling because I serve a God who blows into me.
Come on and praise God. How many of you really chilling today because you got a God that blew breath into you, breathe life into you, breathe hope into you? Thank God for the word of God and the man of God today. Amen. Just chill. Yeah, chillax. Amen. God's hand still wants to lead you. Spirit wants to empower you and equip you. Ezekiel in that text was obedient to the command of God. It didn't make sense to him. But oftentimes God's plans and processes don't make sense, because if you could figure it out, then you don't need God. But he was obedient to the leading of God our Father. And right now, maybe the Spirit of God is speaking to your heart, speaking to you. God wants to do something in you and through you and with you. Are you willing to be obedient today and say yes to the Spirit's leading? If that's so, won't you come? I want to extend you an invitation to make that decision on today. If that's you, why don't you just come from where you are? Never been part of church, never been baptized, won't you say yes and do that today and say, you know what? I want to give my life to Christ. I want to come today. Or perhaps you're here, you used to be part of the church, you want to recommit, reconnect yourself to Christ, to this church, to his church. I want to extend to you also that invitation, that opportunity. I don't want you to miss it. I don't want you to miss it. Amen. I don't want you to miss it. And do that on today. Just as you are. And that's the beauty of God's love, so different than man's love, because God, just as you are, he'll receive you, he'll take you, just as you are, and he'll do that right now. Won't you come and give yourself to him? Brand new start, new beginning, brand new life, and he's just waiting for you to say yes. And to come. Home and family, I want to extend to you that opportunity, this invitation to do that right now. You can bring closure to that deliberation. You've been wondering, hemming and hawing, should you? You can bring closure right now. Just say yes. You know what? I think I want to become part of this fellowship and continue to move forward. Live out my day serving God. Getting on to God's agenda for my life. That's you. Why don't you say yes? You got a church home? Let me see your hand. You have a church home and membership? Got an active church membership? Let me see your hand. Let me see your hand. Look next to you, someone in front of you, lower your hand. Their hand wasn't up. Say, why not today? My brother, my sister, I'll walk with you. I walk with you today. Brother, I walk with you today. 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 Say, I walk with you today. I walk with you today. Yeah, I walk with you today. I walk with you today. Walk with you today. Someone else, I walk with you today. I walk with you today. Someone else, someone else, someone else, someone else. Oh, I wouldn't miss this opportunity. Someone hand wasn't up. Tell them I'll walk with you one more time. Tell them I will walk with you. I will walk with you. I will walk with you. Amen. We thank God. Celebrate God. Hey, Gabby. You're a greeter today, huh? All right. Well, Jazzy, I know you. Amen. I'm going to give you back to your daddy and your mama here. How about that? All right. Come on, daddy. Amen. Amen. I got to say to you, you grew up in this church, so amen. I want you to just go with Brother Cross right there and see him get your particulars. How about that? All right? Yeah, we'll do that. I'll let your dad go with you, too. You'll feel a little better him walking with you. Yeah, there you go. Come on and say amen and thank God for the word today. Praise the Lord. Listen, it's offering time. It's wonderful. I thank God. This has been a fabulous youth month. I want to thank God for all of the youth leaders. You know, the tip of the spear on that youth team is Reverend Murray and Sister Marilyn, but they have a tremendous staff of volunteers, and they couldn't get it done without all of the hard work of those who volunteer, those adults who volunteer in this youth ministry and have passion for them. So I'm thanking God for all the youth workers and youth leaders who commit themselves and have been doing it for many years. Many of them have been doing it quite a while. And what's wonderful is that some of the youth workers now were adults. They're adults now, but they grew up in the church, and so that's beautiful that the legacy continues. And so I know that's encouraging to those youth leaders who have done all that work and hard work in them. I know come to mind somebody like Chris Flowers, who started at this church years ago as a little usher. And now he's an usher supervisor for our young people. Isn't that beautiful? Isn't that beautiful? He comes to mind particularly at one of those incidents. And so we've been celebrating this month, it's been a fabulous, fabulous, fabulous month. So thank all the parents and everyone for committing your children to their ministries, and I'm thankful for you, because we couldn't do it without the parental participation. We need the parents to help us, and as we partner with you point your children in the right direction, because there's so many things and avenues that are taking them away from a Christ-centered life. And so as we partner with you, giving them that firm foundation, and so they can stay connected and committed to Christ. Even those who are graduating, going on off to college, they ain't going to be in your care, but they can be in your prayers. Amen. That they will hold fast to what they know as they are being tempted from every side to step outside of who they are. And you got to know who you are, right? Remember, you got to know who you are. Amen. You got to know who you are in Christ. Now, we're getting ready to receive our offering. I know next month the children are going to Minnesota on a mission trip. On a mission trip. Some youth are going up there. Lawrence, where's Lawrence? Somewhere around here. Oh, where are you, Lawrence? Lawrence is right there. Lawrence has been on a couple mission trips already. And in July, he's going to Ghana. Amen. So he's going across the water. And then we have some others that's going up to Minneapolis, St. Paul. They're going to be there for the week doing some mission work. Earlier this month, children were at St. Ben's serving dinner, and we prepared the food here. Thank those volunteers, everyone who prepared the food here. They went down there and serving. And so I'm thankful for the children that we are exposing them to the work of the church, as they share their faith and as they become the hands of God and the heart and expression of God's love for people and service. So I know the children this month had assessment, and for one child, I think it was $20, et cetera, on to some kind of graduated way. But I want to, those of you who will, I want you to help make sure that we got to get Lawrence. I want to give him some more money, make sure, because I don't want him living off of potted meat and Roman noodles and stuff over there. Amen. Amen. And then the kids that's going to Minnesota, We gotta send go for them to get them squared away. They've been trying to do their own little fundraisers, but we can help them out. Those of you who will, you can do that. So on your envelope where it says Youth Church, just put whatever you want to give to that today to help those children in that effort. And then I know they're probably going to do something else come this fall, so they'll have a little money in their kitty for their next outing as they do some school supplies or give some kids something for the starting back, some hygiene kits or whatever. All right? Amen. The earth belongs to God. Everything in all the world is His. How can I repay the Lord for all His goodness to me? Will a man rob God? You ask how? The reply was in tithes and offerings. If you give, you will get, and your gift will return in full and overflowing measure, pressed down, shaken together to make room for more and running over. And whatever measure you use to give, large or small, will be used to measure what is given back to you. But remember this, if you give little, you will get little. Together, on every Lord's Day, each of us should put aside something from what we've earned during the week and use it for this offering. our visitors, thank you so much for sharing with us. And if you live out of this city, we pray God's grace upon you as you travel. And on behalf of myself and the members here, please extend greetings to your pastor and church family. You live in the city of Milwaukee, surround the area, have a case of worship with us again. I want you to know our doors are always open to you. And if you're looking for a church where you can grow in Christ, come on over where the table is spread. Feast of the Lord is going on. Our deacon brothers will be down in the front of the sanctuary. They have personal family prayer with you. If you so desire, they shall be there immediately upon our dismissal. So now unto him he's able. He'll keep you from falling, presenting you faultless before his presence in glory. You do it all with exceeding joy, because he is the only wise God and our Savior. So to him, power and might and majesty now and forever. Amen.